Crawfords on TV. Crawford Productions featured in the credits of Australia's favourite shows. The company had a golden run inspired by the man behind it.
In 1964, Crawford Productions hit TV gold with the police drama Homicide. They followed up with Division 4.
Division 4, a Crawford production.
Realising they were onto a good beat, they then made Matlock Police.
Hey, we picked up a pig already!
And then opened The Cop Shop.
Senior Sergeant O'Reilly, a new marvel of this technological age. This little gadget, a pocket-sized alcohol detector.
But Crawfords have made more than just great cop shows. They broke new ground with the espionage series, Hunter.
He is part commando, part detective, part spy. He is Hunter.
And accepted the challenge laid down by number 96 with The Box.
I'm sorry, but you won't be doing tonight's show or any other show.
That TV idea blossomed into a feature film starring Graham Kennedy.
Ah! This must be the place.
Crawford's 70s sitcom, The Bluestone Boys, even featured our very own Denise Drysdale.
Poor Mr. Briggs has amnesia and can't remember anything that happened.
Legions of fans tuned in for the Aussie wartime drama, The Sullivans. Another Crawford showcase was Lorraine Bailey in Carson's Law.
Hello, Mr. Carson.
Good evening, Grandpa.
The hits kept coming with All the Rivers Run, Flying Doctors, and many, many more.
Don't worry about me, darling.
Born Jawa.
Bonjour, it's in French.
And who could forget Acropolis Now?
In Greek, it's a spunat.
Crawford Productions holds a very special place in Australian TV history. Legendary company chief Hector Crawford was honoured with 4 special Logie Awards, and he was the first inductee into the Logies Hall of Fame.
Writer Rozzi Bazzani has spent years researching the work of the famous Crawfords, and she joins us now in Melbourne. Melbourne, Rozzi, how are you?
Hi, Anthony. Hello, everyone.
Now, they say that there's always a woman behind a successful man, allegedly. In this case, it was Hector Crawford's sister.
That's right. It probably is true, actually, don't you think? There's always a good woman behind a successful man. But Dorothy Crawford was, in a way, the silent partner behind Hector Crawford. They were very close. They were together in music and radio before television, and I cover that in the book as well. 25 years before television broke, they were enormously successful. But his sister, from the word go, was interested in more the drama side of things, and she was a pretty incredible character. And as I explore in the book, fairly long lives, both of them. Their lives were pretty interesting, as well as the dramas they put on the screen.
And those dramas, they were really very groundbreaking, weren't they, Rozzi? You know, they took a risk. When you think about Homicide first coming onto our screens, it wasn't something that we'd seen before on Australian television.
No, well, that's the thing. And, of course, with so much terrific television coming from the US and from the UK, television was late coming to Australia, been going in other parts of the world for a long time. And so it was probably easy for the television owners at that time to just want to screen these wonderful programs. But Hector Crawford really had an axe to grind, if I can put it that way, that he definitely believed that we in Australia needed to see our own stories, hear our own voices and see ourselves to understand who we are. Mm. And they had quite a struggle to get Homicide up, but they eventually did, and, of course, you know, the rest is history, really.
Mm. And what about Cop Shop? Paula, you were in Cop Shop, weren't you?
Yes, I was. I was in Cop Shop for 6.5 years, 6 of the most fabulous years ever. it was a wonderful invention, really, Cop Shop, because we had all the drama going upstairs, but then downstairs we had this ridiculous comedy happening, you know, featuring Terry Norris and Gil Tucker and the likes of. And, you know, we'd have plagues of spiders and rats, and in the middle of it we'd be out there doing the drama, we'd be up... The girls, Linda Stoner and myself, were running around in T-shirts in the freezing cold winter with no bras on sometimes. And
looking
extremely
fabulous.
High-heeled shoes and capturing people like Mel Gibson and the likes of. That was a lot
you
of fun.
You said Hector Crawford was kind of like a father figure to the cast and crew.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, we would go there for Sunday lunches, you know, and literally to the house.
Oh, wow.
And you know, and he would talk us through about what was happening and where he wanted to see the industry go and if we had any problems with our characters. And, you know, our producer at the time was Murray Trevor, who was liaising backwards and forwards with this. And it was funny, we were often wanting great feedback, you know, about our performances, you know. So we'd ring and I'd ring him back, you know, after an episode and he'd go, I really don't like your hair like that. You must wear it. I like the flick. You must have the flick. But it was legendary time. We felt totally safe. And I think he's responsible for building our Australian television industry, without a doubt.
Absolutely. And, of course, Hector Crawford also won many awards, including the Logies we mentioned earlier. Rozzi, what do you think inspired him? Why was he so passionate about making Australian TV?
He had enormous success in radio, I suppose, Joe. And he saw the reaction after the Second World War, when overseas supplies of programs was cut off, and it inspired him and his sister and other producers in radio as well. He saw that reaction and saw how important it was. And he also, they had more than a working knowledge of the Australian film industry that had tried and struggled over the years to get up, to see some of our own stories and our own brilliant actors and writers and so on. And he just had that idea that we must have that ourselves to know who we are to be a proper country. Mm. And he absolutely never let go of that. But what Paula was saying about that family situation, the serials came really in the latter part of Crawford's television time, if I can put it that way. Prior to that, they'd always wanted these self-contained dramas. But what Paula was describing about Hector and Dorothy being like stage mother and father to
definitely,
a lot of their actors,
definitely.
That carried all the way through. I know many of you will know Sonia Borg,
yes.
Who started off as a writer at Crawford's and then produced films in her own right. Sonia told me that when she started out, Dorothy used to tell her to wear false eyelashes, she had to wear
yes,
wigs, and she had to be absolutely dressed to the nines all the time. And so it was a family company, really huge, but created enormous opportunity for everyone, and I couldn't agree with Paula more. They're at the base of everything. How lucky we are to have had them.
Yeah. And that's because them terribly.
They came from a theatrical background, didn't they?
Well, their beginnings, that's their beginning actually was, and probably it's hard for us now to project ourselves back to pre-war Australia, Denise, but they had drama that started in their local church hall, basically. Hector and Dorothy started producing plays in their own group, within their own church. And then the Dorothy Crawford Players came out of that, and she was obviously trying to do Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, and the church would much rather she produced the Bishop's Candles or something. So she was always absolutely out there, a woman totally ahead of her time. Mm. And Hector and Dorothy together, it's been said that they were a formidable combination. Mm. She preferred to stand back behind her brother and just be solidly producing drama and following the systems. And he stood out on the cliff, was the face of it, chased it down, always took risks. And they were very close. They laughed and joked and used to tease each other all the time. He called her Do, as in Do Re Mi, you know, the tonic chord, her being the bass and the root note of everything. They were very close. He valued her enormously, and they were a formidable combination.
Mm-hmm. Well, Rozzi, amazing story.
It absolutely is. Just a golden time in Australian TV. Well, Rozzi Bazzani's great book is called Hector. Look for it where all good books are sold. Let's all thank the wonderful Rozzi Bazzani.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.